is our roast master of Fredericksburg, owner of Ranch Road Roasters. And he's speaking for us today with our form called Fred Talks. And Fred Talks is a community forum for the creative genius to speak. And we came up with this idea about 6 months ago, and we've had 4 Fred Talks now. And as we meet people in our community who are doing fabulous things and have great ideas or have produced something amazing, whether it be art or an art form, we want to put those people in a place to speak about what they do. And tonight we have Daniel Ringer. So I interviewed Daniel about a week ago about what we might talk about for the Spread Talk. And I'm going to get on the other side of you, because I want you to be blind there. And I'll sit down after I answer your question.
Okay.
I'm going to go ahead and lead him through a series of 5 questions, and based on our interview that we had a week ago. And at the end of his talk, if you all have any questions that you'd like to ask, you may. This Fred Talk series is uploaded to YouTube, and we are creating a library of our Fred Talks for our community. So, to begin, Daniel, before you became a cuffologist,
yes,
you were working for a brewery in Alaska.
That's correct.
How did you make the leap from beer to coffee and from Alaska to Texas?
Those are a couple big leaps there. But there's some, with the coffee and the brewing, there's some similarities. So I started off in a brewery up in Alaska, and many moons ago, there was just a handful of breweries in the entire state. So I saw it as an opportunity maybe to open up a brewery. So I had a partner, and we worked really hard on a location, and before closing, our location burnt down. So, and I guess it's a blessing in disguise, we had to start over, and because our loan was based on an existing building business, and then the loan would change because we would be building a building and not have a business for a while. So instead of spending our own money, I thought it'd be nice if I maybe, sometimes they say, spending somebody else's money. So I got a job at a brewery in Anchorage, Alaska, and I worked my way basically from the bottom up to the top almost. I was operation manager. And it was nice because I got to see how money hemorrhages. I got to see how ideas maybe look good on paper and sometimes don't work. So it was a nice learning experience for me. But beer is real exciting because it's part of the environment, the malt, the hops, all the ingredients that come from the earth. And it's different in different parts of the earth, the world. And it's you have a dry season, you have a wet season, so it's not always consistent. But you're creating a flavor based on your palate. So usually a brewer will brew beers that they like, and it's to their palate. So wine, beers, and coffee are very similar, that these raw ingredients, and they have these attributes, these flavors from where they come from. And so the leap from brewery to coffee, it was similar in that I was buying a raw product, and I was creating a flavor that I liked to my palate. And then the leap from Alaska to Texas is really about family. There's a disconnect when you live in Alaska. It's 5,000 miles from here. It's a 3-hour time zone difference. And if you look at airfare from Anchorage coming down to lower 48, you can get from Anchorage to Seattle for $500 round trip, and you can also go to Florida for $500. It's almost like they just charge you $500 for leaving the state. And so if we moved to Texas, my in-laws are in Washington State. It allowed us to see my family here in Texas and take advantage of these cheaper flights from Washington and back. And when our son was born in Alaska, we really thought it would be important that he would get to know his cousins, his aunt and uncles, his grandparents, and at the time he had great-grandparents. And so we moved to Fredericksburg. So that was the leap from brewery to coffee at Alaska to Texas. With one last thing. When we're moving to Texas, my wife has got a master's in education, so she immediately want to make sure she had all her paperwork in place to teach in Texas. I started looking at what brewery options I had and how far I would be commuting. And we were originally just going to do the exact same thing we were doing in Alaska. And then we decided together to take a risk and do something that was unforeseen. And every time we came to visit to Freshburg, my wife wasn't a big fan of the coffee. And so she thought it was her idea that maybe we would roast coffee. And then we roasted it to our palate, something we liked, so we would have coffee that we would enjoy. But that's how we ended up roasting and moving here. And then, and I guess the big reason we did it, the jobs and profession we had before, it worked well with our son, that he was always with the parent. But my wife and I were tag teaming, so when she got home from school, I was going to the brewery. And so it was not ideal for us as a couple because we were hardly seeing each other. It was almost a handoff with our son, Golden. And by taking a risk and doing our own business, we could create a business that operated around our family needs. So we don't have traditional hours. So I'm not 7 days a week. I'm not at 6 in the morning. I mean, we're Monday, over Wednesday through Saturday, 8 to 2. And that schedule works with all the drop-off and pickups with our family and our kids. And so that's another reason we chose to do the coffees morning program.
Fantastic. As our local roastmaster, I've heard you say that a cold coffee never lies. What should a consumer be tasting in a good cup of coffee, and how is it different from ordering a caramel mocha latte at Starbucks?
That's a good question. So there's a saying, and not a lot of people know about it, but it's a cold coffee should never doesn't lie. And you've probably seen it at the office, where someone has some coffee. As soon as it gets cold, they stick it in the microwave. If it gets a little luke or just a little cold, they take a sip and they kind of make that face. But when something's hot, it mats flavors. So cold coffee never lies. Means that even at room temperature, that coffee should taste good. If it does not taste good, there's a flaw. There's a flaw in either the beans are used or usually in the roasting. So when I got here, I poured myself a cup, and I always let my cup get to room temperature, because that way you can smell a bit more, and what you smell falls through with your taste, so you get more of the aroma. This, what you're drinking here is Antigua Guatemala beans. I know several poured them, it's hot, but now that you've been holding it, it's probably a little cooler, but you would get more of the aroma. And the goal for me is I don't really believe that there's necessarily bad coffee. It's just that you might not like that type of coffee because maybe you don't like that Roastmaster's palate. You know, so for my palate, what I like, I like the flavor to be right there in front, but I like it to dissipate. So every time I take a sip, it's almost like, and then it resets and then you get to try it again. I don't want to chew on it. I don't want to linger. So when I have cold coffee, that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking like, so this is Antigua Guatemala beans. I'm looking for a nose that's kind of got a little bit of citrus. Maybe just very subtle cinnamon. But on this particular roast, they call this kissing the second crack. So I start the roast just shy of the second crack, and the coffee will crack once, and crack twice. And almost everything you drink is around that second crack. It's either before, during, or after. So all these breakfast blends, medium roast, dark roast, French roast, they're all around that second crack. The fruit is right before that second crack. So this is what I call kissing the second crack. You didn't quite let it happen. As soon as it happens, the sugars will caramelize. And then you start getting different flavors. You get caramel, you get chocolate, tobacco. So on this one, I let it stop. So there might be a subtle cinnamon, but I didn't want the caramelized brown sugar. I didn't want to go back and I want to leave it fruity. And when you taste it, you should taste some coffee. Should have a real bright finish, and it's what they call sometimes a fruity coffee, but it's not really fruity. I mean, it's coffee, it tastes like coffee, but that fruitiness is just that bright citrus at the end. I don't know if anybody picked that up. Just, and this Antigua Guatemala beans, it's just real clean, real smooth, single origin. You can take the same roast and you can blend it with another farm if you wanted to create different flavors, but it's just kind of nice to know what comes from one farm. And then on this one roast, it's kind of hard to tell from afar, but these are both Antigua Guatemala beans. So I did one that you're drinking, this one right here, which It's bright and fruity. I took the same farm, the same origin, and I did a dark roast where you get some chocolate and caramel, and I roasted the fruit out. And you could do a blend from that same farm, from the same beans, and achieve different flavors. That second part of the question was, how would it differ from, say, Starbucks? And I think that is the quandary for all roasters as they grow. I think the first thing you want to do is buy the best equipment that you can buy. You don't want to start with something that you don't like, have a product you don't like, try to have a brand of something you don't like, hoping that one day you're going to have enough money to get the equipment and then redo it all. Because what happens, you end up creating a base and then you're going to change your flavor. But when as you roast coffee and you get the roaster that you like, that you can afford, the smaller the batch, the more even the roast is. The larger the batch, the more heat you have to apply to it. And an easy way to think about it is almost like a big barge, a container ship. A barge moves very slow. So it leaves point A and it arrives at point B. And if you make any changes on that container ship, it's very subtle. You don't see it, except maybe you got a few minutes down the road. So when you're roasting coffee, a lot of times you got to be 2 minutes proactive. So anything you're going to change, it's 2 minutes ahead of time to see those results. So if you have a smaller batch of beans, you can get that container to move. If you have a very large batch, so something like Starbucks, they have a central roaster that they roast from multiple locations. It has to hit with a lot more heat to get those beans to move. And when you do that, it's harder to do some of the stuff we're just talking about, where like a full city roast, where you just kiss the second crack and get the citrus, the fruitiness, because they hit it with so much heat. It's just hard to maintain it. So I think what you'll see is a difference from a lot of smaller roasters versus a bigger roaster is that they maybe have a more even roast. And then the quandary be, as you grow, what do you do? So I've seen it where some people go as large as they can, but keep that profile, that roast profile that they enjoy. And if they grow more, that they add just the same roaster right next to it, the same roaster right next to it. And you can kind of toggle and get this roaster going, get this one going 2 minutes later, this one 2 minutes later, and that way, and you've got your log sheets, and you can do it. And I've seen some where, as the business grows, and they add a new location, they only roast on site, and then they have weekly to monthly meetings with all the roasters, and they all cut their coffee, and they just want to make sure that each location is, you know, roasting that varietal that they're selling. But if you're just going to go with one central roaster, it's hard. So I don't know if you've seen, like, beans are real oily. You open a bag, and it's just got, like, looks like it's just shiny. That means it was hit with a lot of heat. So you know that roaster is a big roaster.
And it's spicy. That's not a good thing.
That's not a good thing. See? So that's a flaw on the roast. So right now, it's nice for me because I can do about 300 pounds a day. I get to do the roast I enjoy. And I have two roasters, so if I need it, I can fire both of mine. So usually I just use one right now.
So 300 pounds is considered a small batch?
Well, I do 300 pounds in a day, but really anywhere between, say, like 15 pounds to 35 pounds, you count a small batch. And once you hit over 35 pounds, you're just hitting it with a lot more heat. And this becomes challenging. And some of these roasters, one burlap bag is about 150 pounds, and you can have an automatic loader, and you take that whole bag and you unload 150 pounds all at one time, and you roast it all at one time, but you do hit it for a lot of heat.
Okay, thank you. The coffee culture seems to have its own language. When you serve a customer and say, single origin, passive organic, dark Arabica, is that how I say it?
Arabica.
With hints of vanilla. It sounds serious and scientific. What do these words actually mean?
Okay, so we got, single origin, which I'm a big fan of that. So all coffee roasters are different. So this Rancho Roaster, what we do, we buy direct from farms. We're single origin, and that means we don't blend. We buy from one farm, and then we buy the best beans that we can that are on the market. And usually what we do is we buy passive organic or organic. And when you have a harvest, coffee is cut, and that's a cup score. So if you have 5 acres and you have a harvest, it gets cupped, and so you get a score of 89. That is what you can sell those for that year, that year's harvest. The higher your cup score, the higher you can sell your beans. The lower your cup score, the less your beans are worth. And the reason I'm a big fan of single origin kind of bridges over from the brewery. I like, if I have a Belgian beer, I like to taste Belgian water, Belgian malts, hops. I want to taste everything that's from that origin. I don't want a Belgian style that was made somewhere in the U.S. And it's a style, but you don't know what you're tasting. I always like to know what I'm drinking. So on our coffee, we do single origin. So when I we buy Costa Rica, Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, Ecuador, Chiapas beans, and we toggle between Tanzania and Kenya pepe. But I only buy them from one farm. And when I roast it, I leave it as a single origin. And I don't even do co-ops, because at a co-op, you can go to an area that you might like, and if there's a co-op, you could have a good farmer and a bad farmer, and the beans get blended together. So there's nothing wrong. I just like a single origin all from one farm, and I just like to know what I'm tasting. If somebody wants a blend, a restaurant,